church. Happy birthday, America. Happy birthday to our Annas. Karen today. A lot of birthdays. Faye's too?
Yeah, we share. We share the same day.
Wow. Does that mean something? Praise the Lord. Let's open in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and love. Thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you for your son, Jesus, dying on the cross for each one of us, and that we can personally invite him in to be our Savior and our Lord. Thank you for all of your Holy Spirit that is within us and guides us and directs us, if we'll allow it, Lord. We pray that you'll just take control of our service today. Help us to celebrate the holiday. Honor you in everything we do, Lord. We pray for Karen as she plays so beautifully. Thank you for Dave as he leads us in worship and messages and councilmen and everything. And thank you for Rich and Tony as they being councilmen for and leadership for our church. We thank you for the ladies caring and sharing. Thank you for Jen as she does so much of the technology for our services, Lord. The Sunday school teachers and all the ministries that are in our church today, Lord Jesus. Bless everybody who's watching, everybody who's listening, Lord. Help us the desire to have you change us to be more like your son. We give you all the praise, honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you haven't picked up a bulletin, please get one from the back. The scripture reading today is Psalm 119, 43 through 45. Never take your word of truth from my mouth, for I have put my hope in your laws. I will always obey your law forever and ever. I will walk about in freedom, for I have sought out your precepts. Praise the Lord. Our day is going to come and lead us in worship. Please worship the Lord as we're allowed to do in our country. Amen.
What a blessing we have to live in a country where we have freedom of religion and we can sing as loud and long as we want about what we believe. Let's stand, shall we? My country tis thee. Happy anniversary, Kevin and Kelly also. This week, we had a memorial service for one of our former teenagers, and it was way out in central Pennsylvania. Real good service. She was a pastor's wife, and it was really neat. Her three daughters were talking about how much influence the Harveys had on her during these teenage years. And it's neat to see the generations of believers that maybe we had a little influence along the way, but it was really neat. But God decided to take her home about a month after she found out she had cancer. And they were still saying, well, we can still do radiation. She said, nope, I'm done. But anyway, it's a real neat service, not many tears at all because of the life that she led. Her three daughters said they don't remember an angry word ever being spoken in their home. The whole time they were growing up. Now, we can't say that. But anyway, she was just that kind of girl. Her maiden name was Cherry, and she hung on to that cherry. Everything that was in it, and they couldn't be berries of any other kind. They had to be cherry. But everything that she saw in a thrift shop or anything else that was cherries, I mean, she just hung on to that. Just a real name. Her name was Dale. But the point I'm getting to, we drove right past Pottstown. Hello, Josie and Michael. So on our way back, we got a hold of them, and we stopped in to see Josie and Michael in their new home. They're getting involved in the community, and Josie's in a Bible study with some of the ladies in the community, and also, so we spent a couple of hours there. And this is Josie and Michael. This is the back of their home, and they're a real pretty lake, and she feeds the ducks, and they see the fox come up and around, and the geese and things like that. But anyway, really did have a good time. And before we left, we got into a group hug and had a word of prayer with them, and they really miss our church, and they faithfully do watch it, our services and things like that. But they said, well, since you're heading back to there, can we give you a couple things to take back with us? So they brought a couple cards back with us. And where did Josh go? I don't see him in here, but I didn't. Come on up, Josh. So this is a special delivery from Josie and Michael. And also, Josh's birthday was on Friday. And if you check your Venmo account, you'll see something in there from your church family. And Nancy has something for you there.
Okay, this is from the ladies, Karen and Sharon, since you're so special to us all. It's a gift card of Billy's gift card. You may need Jacob, somebody. So then he will be at Billy's.
You're
going to
have to the birthday.
But anyway, so here's all your stuff.
All my stuff. Oh, I've got some weight to it. Thank you so much.
Special delivery from Josie and Michael. And thank you.
Josie and Michael. I love this church. Ladies, Karen, Sharon, you guys are amazing. Thank you so much. And you announced that, but to the ladies, Karen, Sharon, tomorrow, right?
No.
We're not going to do it this summer? What? Men are meeting tomorrow?
Tomorrow's a holiday.
Council meeting tomorrow? No. Why? I'll make it.
Tomorrow's a holiday.
What's that?
You'll be in the hospital if you want.
Is that what I'll be? Nancy's a prophet over there. She's like, tomorrow. But no, it's interesting. I won't go into that. But yeah. You pray for, we'll transition to prayer since you're talking about my wife. She's still in bed right now. Awesome, good, because she needs rest. But she's had trouble sleeping. I'm not trying to, look, you. Most of you, I'm looking at half a dozen, if not, you guys know what she's going through more than I could even explain it to you. And so, she is pushing 40, so keep her in your prayers. I don't know if that makes a difference to the pain she's feeling, to her insides. And Captain, your hair looks awesome this morning. You look amazing. But I saw you for the first time. I was in the back. Keep Crystal in your prayers because I told Karen this morning, the first 37 and a half weeks of this pregnancy, not a problem for her. The last week and a half, she's 2 weeks, she's been in a lot of pain, a lot of discomfort, lack of sleep, which causes all the other things. So just keep her in your prayers. She's going to be here, and I told her to stay in bed because. Anyway. So, keep Crystal in your prayers. George, you see Margie's not here this morning. She sent out a text message. I know some of you got the text message this morning, and that she's right now at Lord's Hospital with George. George, I mentioned Sunday school, that she sent him a text message too, that he has bile, the cancer was blocking parts of his liver where the bile could not flow through. So they had to put a stent in to allow the bile to flow through. And the plan is to just keep it, monitor it, and look, do a blood test in a week or so, next couple of days. And if everything goes good, the liver numbers are down, and then the bile numbers are down, then they will continue with chemotherapy next week. So pray that that's the case, that we can, that God be glorified in this whole situation. Pray for Margie. Anyone who has a spouse or has loved ones who have been in and out of the hospital knows the stresses that she's probably experiencing right now, the worries, and just all the weight on her. And then George is planning for him to go to rehab. That's so necessary for Margie, because to have her be able to take care of him at home, he needs to get rehabilitated. So pray for his rehab, that goes smoothly. So continue to pray for George and Marge, because the physical pain for George and the emotional pain for Margie. They need our prayers, they need our support, they need our love. So call, text her, stop by. I know Wally asked if they can visit sometime this week, so tomorrow. So visit her, visit him. Either or, go to Lord's or go to Albion. You know, either one, make sure you're visiting Margie, George. What else do we need to be praying for? I know there's a few other things that are on our list. Well, Mike and Josie, Dave mentioned Sunday school. Just keep them in your prayers. Just think family issues. They've had issues with their grandson, granddaughter. The daughter having some issues now. Just keep them in your prayers, because as being the leaders of their family, the spiritual leaders, I know when they see struggles and challenges in their daughter, the grandkids or their daughter, it has an effect on them significantly. So pray for Mike and Josie. We pray that they can make an impact. Pray for their daughter and their grandkids as well. So what else are you praying for? Jen asked us to pray for a few things. What's this? Anything else we can pray for? Any updates? No? Alright. You guys can see the list here. I don't want to go through each specific thing. But make sure that throughout this week, you're praying for these individuals. That's how we join our hearts together. That's how we lift one another up. And allow God to use you. And we'll talk specifically about that in the service. But if there's nothing else. How you doing, Faye? Happy birthday.
Okay.
I saw your name on here, so that's right.
I want to say, when we were talking about praying for Margie took the time to actually call me this morning and wish me a happy birthday. And that just shows the strength that she has.
Huh. She only texted me on my birthday.
I know.
You got a phone call. Use us to strengthen one another. Lord, we thank you for the privilege we have that we can do your business. alert. We thank you. We thank you for this privilege. So use us. Use us to make an impact on this body. Use us to make an impact on our communities, in our places of business, our families, our homes. Father, we pray that you are making an impact on our hearts this morning. And Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the freedoms we have in this country. Lord, we celebrate those freedoms this weekend. And Lord, we pray that as we celebrate them, that you protect and that you continue to provide the safety and that we need. But Lord, we thank you for these freedoms. We thank you for this country that we... And right now, Lord, we lift up our elected officials, that you instruct us to thank you for them, and we do. We thank you for the freedoms that we have, that we can elect these officials. And Lord, we thank you for the authorities that you've placed there. For whatever reason, whatever, we thank you for it. We ask that you help them to make decisions according to your will and your word. Lord, we praise you for the ways that decisions are being made, and we pray that you be glorified in the ways that people are conforming to your word and your will. Country, we thank you for it. Continue to protect this country. Continue to protect your people in this country. Continue to thank you for the freedoms we have. Lord, we thank you for you come here this morning and right now. We thank you for these freedoms and pray you bless. Bless each heart, each soul, each mind, each spirit, each person who gave up of their time to come here and see you. Lord, right now, change our thoughts, our mind, our hearts. Help us to seek your kingdom, seek your righteousness as we conform to the image of your Son. See you conform to your will. We thank you. So bless this body now. Bless each individual, each heart. Bless us as a body, as a community, Lord. We pray that at all we do here this morning will bless the name of the Lord to bring you to glory, honor, praise, and exalt you as you so deserve. We thank you. So prepare us and ready us as we give you that glory. We thank you for it all. We pray it all in Jesus' name. You guys have 3 minutes, 180 seconds. Make sure you greet one another. Let one another know if you're praying for them. Tell them you're praying for them. Or if there's someone that you need prayer, ask them what they're praying for about. Tell them you're happy to see you. Or no one's listening to you. I do have a week. No, I'm thinking about you. Have you ever taken it and then done it?
Okay, let's find our seat, shall we? Praise Him, praise Him.
Sometimes it's at work. I don't do it at work, but some of us might just go through the motions. You go to work, you don't have to think about what you're doing, you don't have to think about where you're at, what, you know, you just go through the motions and be on default, you know, not even thinking about it. A lot of times, sometimes, whether it's when we come home, hopefully our relationships aren't like that, we just go through the motions. Sometimes maybe it's cooking food or chores, and sometimes those are our default settings. We don't even think about it, we just go through the motions and we just cook or just do chores, and we don't even pay attention sometimes to the things we're doing. We don't give it the focus. That's exactly why Jesus instituted communion. Because far too often when it comes to our spiritual walk, it falls into a default setting. You know, I go to church on Sundays and you know, I'll go to Bible study or I'll text or I'll pray for that person. I'll read my Bible and we just go through the motions. And sometimes we don't even think about the fact that there's an effort, there's an emotion, there's an application, there's an attitude. There's a focus that we need to be having. We just go through the motions. And it's kind of interesting because communion was instituted for that exact purpose. And it's neat because communion comes from Passover. All right? And Passover, just like any one of us, how often do we fall into default around the holidays? We just go through the motions. You know, yeah, that's what we do. Every Christmas we do that. Oh, that's what we do on Easter. Oh, that's what we do. And we do 4th of July. Oh, barbecue. We don't even think about what the freedoms. We don't think about the purpose. We go through the motions. And how neat was it that on this holiday, that the Jews celebrated about their freedoms, about the being, about the redemption, about being set apart, sanctified, and these purposes that God had for his people, they just went through the motions. And that's why Jesus instituted communion. And he instituted it to help them see the focus, see the importance of this holiday. He set them separated, his table, these elements separated apart to show that this had a specific purpose. And then we take this and we go through the motions. And that's why Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians what we read each month. On the first Sunday of each month, he said, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So make sure we don't go through the motions. We don't just do it because it's habit. We don't do it because it's ritual or it's a default setting. But we do this with an attitude, with a thought, with an intention in mind. Do this in remembrance. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." There's a purpose to it. "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup in an unworthy manner, going through the motions without realizing the importance and the specifics." Well, anyone who does this eats and drinks the cup of the Lord and unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body. The blood of the Lord. But it says, "But then let a man examine himself first. So let him eat and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks judgment himself, and he does not judge the body rightly." So what we do is we just, and I say it every month, we stop. We stop allowing ourselves to go through the motions. We stop allowing ourselves to drift away. We stop and we check ourselves out. We just gauge yourself. Do a quick personal inventory, spiritual inventory. What's going on in my life? Why? Is there relationships that need to be mended? Is there things that I need to acknowledge to God that, hey, I put this before you, and then we confess. You just examine the body and you confess. And that's what we're going to do now. So we're going to ask the gentleman to come forward, those who are going to distribute. It's always different. Walt knows he's one of them. Charlie looks at him. Charlie's either. So, and we'll just ask God now. Bless these elements and those who receive them. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can approach your table. Father, we thank you for this communion, that we can commune with our Savior, with our God, with our Creator, with our Lord. Lord, we thank you for this time and that you instituted this for a purpose. And right now, we pray that you help us to do this purpose, do this in remembrance of what you've done for us. So bless, Lord, bless this bread and bless those who partake it. Draw us into your presence and help us to see the sacrifice and truly do this in remembrance of what has been done for us. We thank you, Father. We thank you for it. We ask for your blessing upon it. And we pray it all in Jesus' name. cups that are drank during the Passover Seder. The first is the cup of deliverance. It says, I would bring you out from the burden of the Egyptians. Each cup comes from a promise God made in Exodus chapter 6 to Israel. The second cup is a cup of sanctification. I will rid you of your bondage. I will bring you out from the burden of the Egyptians. I will rid you of your bondage. It's the second cup. And the third cup, the cup after supper, is the cup of redemption. It comes from Exodus chapter 6, verse 7. It says, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and a mighty act of judgment. 1,500 years before Jesus went to the cross, God said, I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and a mighty act of judgment. And then Jesus said, this cup, that promise, this cup is the new covenant. Not the old covenant, the 613 laws that you couldn't keep. This is a new covenant that I will redeem you with a mighty act of judgment. And he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which will be poured out for the sins of many. And then they went out to the Mount of Olives singing hymns.
We're going to sing this two times. Let's stand, shall we, the first time with the piano, and then the second time without the piano, as we quiet our hearts to prepare ourselves for what God wants to teach us from His Word this morning.
Return from a 2-year missions trip. Not 2 weeks, 2 years, somewhere between 18 and 24 months they were on this trip. And this morning, we're going to see them return. They're on the last week, we left them on the final leg of the trip, and this morning we're going to see their return, and we're going to talk about what they do and what that looks like. So before we even get into the word and into the return to Antioch, we're going to ask God to bless our times. Let's do that. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for these truths. Lord, we thank you for your Holy Spirit that speaks to us through your word. And we pray right now, Father, that you are speaking to us through your word, through your spirit. That it's not what I have to say this morning, not my opinions, not my preferences, not my principles, not what I have to say, but what you have in store for us this morning, Father. Well, I pray that you right now speak to each one of our hearts, every one of us who are at different places in our lives. Lord, draw us into your presence right now. Your Holy Spirit speaking to us, convict us, conform us. Right now, Father, not my words, but your words. As you speak to our hearts through me, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this body. And Lord, we pray that you bless now. We pray that this body of believers brings you the glory you so deserve. And we thank you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we've been, for the last 2 months, we've been following Paul and Barnabas around on this, throughout Asia Minor and Galatia and Greece and on this missions trip. And last week we saw how Paul, they went to Lystra, how he was stoned. After preaching the gospel in Lystra, he was stoned and they dragged him outside the city. Those from Antioch and Iconium traveled somewhere from 90 to 110 miles just because they heard Paul still preaching this gospel. So they traveled down and they persecuted him, attacked him, and stoned him, dragged him outside the city, and left him for dead. Then we see as Paul gets back up, goes back into the city, and the next day goes to Derbe and continues to preach. Right there we talked about how he could have went home at that point. He went too far, maybe a day or two's travel from home, but instead he turned around and went back to the cities that persecuted him, back to the cities that stoned him, back to the cities that attacked him, and he, in the intention of strengthening the disciples there. So he went back to Lystra, back to Iconium, back to Antioch. And then we pick up, actually you could have, didn't know the map, and I could use this cool little gift that my birthday present from Kevin Kelly. Sorry, Karen, her is cooler. But they were here in Derbe, and they could have just went to Tarsus where he lived, or back to Antioch, but instead they traveled to Lystra and Iconium and Antioch. And then this morning we're seeing as they go down to Perga, in chapter 14, verse 24, it tells us that, where are we at, Jen? And they passed through Pisidia and came to Pamphylia. And when they had spoken the word in Perga, they went down to Attalia. So, now, understand that 18 months earlier, if you want to pull up that map again for me, 18 months earlier, after they left Cyprus, they came up to Perga. Does anyone know what significant or specific thing, does anyone remember what happened to Perga? What's that? Nope. That's where John Mark deserted them. John Mark, after they left Cyprus, they got to Perga after making this trip on the sea, which is probably like, who knows how long they spent on the sea there, a couple days, if not a week, traveling on the ocean. They get to Perga, and John Mark deserts them. Then chapter 13 tells us that they went up to Pisidia and Antioch. They did not preach the gospel in Perga the first time. I find this so fascinating because, I'm a pragmatist. I like to try to figure out why and figure out the reasons for these things. There's got to be logical, rational reasons or why they've not preached the gospel there. We don't know. We don't know the specific. Now, some might say, well, the Holy Spirit told them not to. We don't know. We don't know. What's neat, though, is he preaches the gospel of Perga now. 18 months. What's cool is maybe the people in Perga were not ready for the word 18 months earlier. 18 months earlier, when they traveled through it, God had them continue. Maybe Paul wasn't ready for the persecution. Perga was a very pagan city. They had all kinds of temples to the different idols and different gods. And maybe Paul wasn't ready at them. He had to go up and face the persecution of Pisidia and Antioch and face that persecution before. Maybe Paul, who knows? Who knows? Maybe the guy who needed to hear the gospel wasn't at home that week. So God said, come back in 18. We don't know the specifics. But what's neat is they preach the gospel here in Perga this time. They preach the word, and then they go to Italian. which interestingly, they doesn't tell us that they ever preached the gospel in Italian. Italian, the reason I'm bringing this up is because I want you to see how we do things, because far we know Paul and Barnabas might have preached there because they didn't preach there because it was their feelings. They got scared, they saw them, the pagan gods, or they didn't. Look, I want us to see how God uses our actions. It does not matter what we think is right. It does not matter what we think we should do. God has a plan. And here it's so cool because Italia became an incredible Christian hub. Perga, not so much. Perga, there's no evidence years later of any Christian activity in Perga. However, Italia, where they didn't preach, Italia became an incredible, this is a port city, a metropolis port city here. So it grew, and it became a Christian hub where 100 years or 200 years after this, Christians were sending out other Christians on missionary trips from Italia. That was it became this Christian hub where they sent people out on mission trips, like Antioch was 150 or 200 years earlier. But what's neat is God has his ways. God's going to work. So often, we don't do things because we think, well, that wouldn't make sense, or that would be uncomfortable. And we think we have our plans, but understand that God has a better plan in store. God will use us if we allow him. And that should be our lesson for this morning. And they went to Perga, then they went to Italia, and they returned back to Antioch. So you can bring that back up now. From there, they sailed to Antioch, and from which they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had accomplished. They got back to Antioch. It was probably about 20, 24 months earlier they left. Paul and Barnabas, over these 20 and 24 months, they traveled some 1,400 miles. Now, you might think, big deal, 1,400 miles. 800 were by foot. Over 500 miles by sea. They probably spent somewhere in the area of 3 weeks on the road. That's not in cities, that's on the road, in dangers of robbers, in dangers of Jews, in dangers of Gentiles, in dangers of countrymen. And 500 miles by sea. He talks about how he stranded, spent a day and a night in the open sea. And we're going to see that later in Acts. But the challenges and the struggles they faced, but they made it home. And I think it's so neat that so often we don't endorse challenges, we don't embrace struggles, because It doesn't seem appealing. It doesn't seem good. It doesn't seem easy. It seems too difficult. We don't allow God to work through us and the amazing things that God can do because we see the struggle. And they from there, they sailed to Antioch, from which they have been commended to the grace. Now, Antioch is the church that sent them out. And they commended them. The church, that word commended actually means to send out, to let go of. So they sent them out. They had been commended to the grace. So Antioch, they were in Antioch. Antioch sent them out to the grace of God. Now I want you to look at what God, that this grace of God is. When we hear the grace of God, actually, if I ask you, when you hear grace of God, what do you think? Anyone want to shout out something and have us all point and laugh at you?
Love.
What's that?
It's love.
Love, okay. Love is absolutely a grace of God.
Unmerited favor.
Dictionary definition, but yes, unmerited favor. But that's so beautiful because unmerited favor. Does anyone deserve anything from God? So everything we get from God is grace. See, that's what we need to understand. Is they sent them out, commended them to the grace of God. They were in Antioch and then let them go. Now they're out into the world and they're in God's grace. As long as they follow God, as long as they listen to God, as long as they do with God, then God will take care of them. There's two aspects, incredible aspects of God's grace we see on Paul's mission trip. One is his protection. Think about the protection that Paul and Barnabas received, not only the travels and the struggles and the attacks and the persecution, but just the daily provisions, that God made sure that they had their food, that God made sure, look, Second Timothy chapter 4, Paul, at the end of his life, when he's writing to Timothy, he talks about his mission, his purpose was to preach to the Gentiles. That's why Paul was called. He was called to be an apostle of the Gentiles. And God put him out in the world. And this was his first mission trip to the Gentiles. But the Lord stood with me and strengthened me. What? So that through me, the proclamation might fully be accomplished. And that all the Gentiles, that was God's purpose. God wanted the Gentiles to hear. Paul was going to let it do. You think God's going to fail Paul? No, that's what God wanted. God put Paul in that position. God will equip Paul. He called him. He will equip him. And not only that, but he rescued him out of the lion's mouth. Paul faced incredible challenges. Paul faced incredible dangers. Paul Christopher fears incredible struggles. But he understood that this was God's purpose. God put me here for a reason. God will protect me. So he rescued me all along out of the lion's mouth. That protection. So often we're afraid of what, we have fears, we have anxieties, we have worries, because we think that the world is going to hurt us. Is that what we think? See, understand that Jesus said, I have overcome the world. In the world, you will have tribulations. Jesus promised us that. There's going to be struggles. There's going to be challenges. And Paul faced those challenges. But all the while, he rescued him out of the lion's mouth. He had that understanding of God's protection. So often, we face challenges. We face struggles. And Jesus said, have no fear. You will face tribulations. But I have overcome the world. Last week, we talked about it. Faith is the victory that's overcome the world. And we understand these things. But so often, we have these doubts. That was the beautiful thing about this missions trip is they were going out and they were commended right off the bat to the grace of God. They understood that God is going to protect. They also understood that God is going to empower. Think of the amazing things that Paul and Barnabas did on this missions trip. As they get back, it wasn't by Paul's power, and not only, it wasn't by Paul and Barnabas' power that they traveled, it wasn't by Paul and Barnabas' power that they were able to survive. And definitely was by Paul and Barnabas' power. Remember when they first got to Pisidian Antioch? The head of the synagogue official asked them, hey, is there a word that you want to bring? And Paul gets up there and just gives a history lesson, and people come to Christ. That wasn't by Paul's power. That was by the power of God. And then we see over and over, Paul healed a lame man. You think that was by Paul's power? You think the traveling, the teachings, the preaching, the discipleship, the ability to be in right there by your hometown and to turn back and go back and continue in preaching. That was by the power of God. In Ephesians chapter 3, I love this verse. It says, now to him who is able to do far more abundantly beyond all that we can ask or think, according to the power that's at work within us. See, the same power, we've said this many times, we've read this, the same power that brought Jesus, that rose Jesus from the dead, is at work within you. See, but I want you to understand that God has no limitations. None! God has no limitations. The only limitations are the ones you put on. That's the limitations. He can do far more abundantly, more than we can even think before more. He does. He can do more than I can even imagine. He does more than I can even. He does. How does he do it? According to the power that's at work within me. I'm going to tell you a cute little story. It happened 2 or 3 years ago. Crystal pointed it out to me. I didn't even notice it when it happened. But I can't. I think about it so often. My little nephew, this is about 2 years ago, we were at my sister's for Easter, and my little nephew, throwing a temper tantrum or whatever, takes a sippy cup, and throws it on the floor. Now, every parent has seen a kid do that, right? It's not abnormal. All right? My sister, who has taken child development classes and is a preschool teacher, and she knows how to raise kids, you know, when she sees a sippy cup, what she did immediately? She picks her son up, puts him on the floor, gets a rag, and gets down there, holds his hand, and starts wiping up it up with his hand. He's 2 years old. He has no understanding. Is he cleaning up the mess? Is he cleaning up the mess? No. Does he think he's cleaning up the mess? I can't stop thinking of it, because that right there is a perfect illustration of my ministry. I'm just a naive, ignorant, stupid, incompetent little kid who's working by the power of God. And God's the one holding my hand and just cleaning up the mess. It's not me. It's not. And that's the thing, is we just have to let God use us. He can do abundantly more than we can ever think or ever even imagine according to the power that's in someone else. No. The power's at work within you. You just got to believe it. The only limitations God has are the ones we're putting on. So they return back to Antioch, to where they were commended to that grace. They left 18 months, 2 years earlier, fearful, because they were praying, they were fasting, God sent them out in his grace. That's where God wanted them, so that's what they did. And now they returned back to Antioch and in the grace for the work that they accomplished. Go to next one. When they arrived and gathered the church together, they began to report all things that God had done with them and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles, and they spent a long time with the disciples. When they arrived, they gathered the church together and they began to report all things. This is so important, and I'm just going to say, I wasn't sure how I was going to say this. This is one of the biggest, one of my biggest weaknesses, one of my biggest flaws, one of my biggest challenges. And I don't want to blame anyone else. I want to tell a story, but I don't want to sound like I'm blaming. But I remember 12 years ago, I went on my first missions trip with Lehigh Baptist Church. And on the way home, Karen told me that I had to report to the church what we did on a missions trip. You remember telling me that? So that's what we do. Okay, so I was like, I got important about it. I went and called several kids, called 3 or 4 teenagers, prepared them, got them had a share. When you're going to share what we did this, you're going to share about what this happened, you're going to share about this happened. And I had a whole speech already prepared for myself. I called the pastor Saturday night, hey, just wanted to let you know, we're ready to share what we did on a missions trip. So what's going on? He goes, I think we'll give you 5 minutes between the hymns and the offering. I negotiated with him. I think I got it up to 10 minutes that first year. You know? But I felt like people didn't care. I felt like it didn't matter. It was just my own. I saw it and no one else would. We have kingdom moments every Sunday. We open up with kingdom moments. I don't do that so people can brag. I don't do that so other people can. I do it so we can encourage one another. It's so important. Psalm 66, verse 16, it says, look, come and hear all through God, and I will tell of what he has done for my soul. Those who fear the Lord, those who have the love for the Lord, should have a desire to hear what God is doing. I should have a desire to hear what God is doing in your life, and you should have a desire to hear what God is doing in my life. We should share with one another the works of God and all that he's doing for our souls and all he's doing through us. And it's something that we need to share with one another, but far too often, I'll be honest, I drop the ball in this area. I don't share my kingdom moments because I feel like maybe I'm bragging. I don't share certain prayers or prayer requests because I think maybe no one cares. I feel because I'm a private person, so I don't bring these things up to other people. But every week I have, every day I have kingdom moments, and I don't share them in Sunday school because I don't want to look like I'm. I don't want to. No, let us share what the Lord has done. And far too often we don't share anything because we think no one cares. We don't want to come across as bragging. Far too often, that's why I put, when they returned to Antioch, they reported all that God had done. And in Luke 8:39, it's a story that we all see. Right? It's when the man who was demon-possessed and God cast the demons into the pigs. And we always think of the pigs. We always think of the town. But let's not forget what Jesus said to the man when he left. Return to your house and describe what great things God has done for you. That should be an anthem for so many of us. Go home and describe in great detail all the things that God has done for you. And it's so important. We're told to praise the Lord. We're told to share these things with another. Look, in Galatians chapter 6, anybody who's ever texted me something you got out of the sermon, if you've ever texted me something you got out of the sermon, what was my response? Does anyone know? I text you Galatians 6:6. It says, whoever learns from the word is to share all good things with the person who teaches them. So if you ever receive anything, you're supposed to share with the person who taught you. That, all good things. We're supposed to share with one another. Because it gives God the glory. We're supposed to share with one another because it praises God. And far too often, I'll admit, I've dropped the ball in this area. Whether it's because, like I said, I don't want to blame anyone else but myself. I haven't done this. And you know what? It's 12 o'clock. I was going to have a couple things I'm going to say, but I'm going to close the story right now. So some of you getting, well, we get out of our time instead of later community Sunday. But I'm thinking that his name was the Duke of Wellington. I don't remember his name, but he was the Duke of Wellington. He was the man who defeated Napoleon at Waterloo. Alright, so he's a British commander of an army who defeated Napoleon at Waterloo. He was a very, very rough man. Very tough, very gruff type of mean individual. And his people used to say how he would never compliment. His wife and children talked about how he would never say nice things about people. He was never complimented. He never built people up. He never made people feel good about themselves. He was a great leader, great general, but he just never did those things. And at the end of his life, someone asked him, if you could have to do it over again, what's one thing you'd change? And he said something that's hit me hard. He said, I would praise more. I would give more praise. Now, he's talking about individuals, but it hit me hard because I'm an enthusiastic person. I'm an excited person. And I'd hate for me to stop at the end of my life and look back and say, I wish I gave more praise. God deserves our glory. God deserves our praise. God deserves our exaltation. And far too often, whether it's we get distracted, whether it's because it's awkward and uncomfortable. Look, I think this so often when I go home to my wife, I have a kingdom moment, and I'm like, how do I bring it up? It feels weird. It's my wife! I don't share about my day. It's not something I'm about a private person. So how do I bring this up? How do I mention? And I don't give God the praise he deserves. And because it feels weird. It feels awkward. No. That's my flesh. That's my sin. God deserves the glory. And at the end of my life, I don't want to say, I wish I gave more praise. Look, it's not to people. It's not to individuals. Some of you know, I have no problem complimenting others. I need to make sure I'm giving God the glory that he deserves. And when they returned to Antioch, they brought the church together and reported all that God has done. I just want to point out that we have missionaries all over this world. It's very cool. We have a little European Union going. We have Germany, France, and England. We have the Swedes, the Camels, and the Swords. So we have like the European Union. And we have, look, Sue has reached out to missionaries and she shared things they've done. Jen McCormick has, Karen Torello has, so many people. That's what we need to be doing. We need to reach out to one another. We need to be accomplishing one. We need to share it with one another, the things that God is doing in our lives. Not because you want to bring recognition to yourself. No, because God deserves our praise. God deserves our praise. So, report all the things that God has done and how he's using you to do what he called you to do. He opened the door to the faith of the Gentiles, and they spent a long time with disciples. I'll stop there. I will get to the last part. We'll close in prayer. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you go before us and that you're working behind the scenes in ways we don't even know or understand or can't even comprehend, but we know that you are sovereign and we know that you are all-powerful. So Lord, help us to trust in your way, your provisions, your protection. Help us to let go of our own flesh and our own desires, our own preferences as we seek your kingdom and your righteousness. And Lord, as you do a work in us, in our lives, as you do a work in surrounding us, we pray that we give you the glory that you so deserve, that others will see our good deeds and glorify our Father in heaven, that we will truly give you the praise and the exaltation that you so deserve. So change our hearts, change our attitudes, change our minds as we look to you in praise. Lord, we thank you for all that you do through us. Continue to take glory from us, and we thank you for it. So we ask all these things in Jesus' name.
What a great song to close in. Close with after that. Let's again show you the majesty. Honor and praise. Thank you. that Jesus this morning? If you don't, you can know him. You just need to look to Jesus and say, thank you for dying on the cross for my sins. Ask him for the forgiveness for those sins and ask him to come in and make him the Lord of your life. What a difference it will make. Let's close in prayer, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for, Lord, the ministry of Paul. Lord, he documented these things, the experiences he had, the experiences that he was able to share with others. Lord, even spending time with the disciples after he returned from these missionary journeys. Pray that we might be willing to share the gospel, share the salvation that you've made clear to us, those who believe. Be with us now as we go into the mission field from this place this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.